thank you for coming. Thank you so much. And really, huge congratulations on the victory that you guys had last November. My organization is in D.C. We are what's called a grass tops organization. We're focusing on mobilizing elites around this issue. We've got 140 former senators, governors, and House members already working with us to kind of warm up the environment in Washington. And we touted Seattle as being the great victory that will help give this this cause the shot in the arm that it needs. So Wendell and I wrote this book out of a shared sense of love, heartbreak, and hope. Love for the country, heartbreak over what we think is happening to it, and hope that things can change. We start the book with this. Our country is a dream created during a period of time known as the American Enlightenment, which came to a focal point during the American Revolution and lasted until the early 19th century. The leading political thinkers of the day were the ones that we know so well: Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, James Madison, Thomas Paine, George Mason, Alexander Hamilton, Ben Franklin. Their dream was to create a democratic republic in which the ultimate power rested with the citizens. The Charter of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, written by John Adams — yes, it's true, John Adams wrote almost the entire Constitution for the state of Massachusetts — which was ratified in 1780, 7 years before the U.S. Constitution actually served as a boilerplate for the U.S. Constitution, has this in it. This is Part 1, Article 7 of the Massachusetts Charter. Quote, "Government is instituted for the common good, for the protection, safety, prosperity, and happiness of the people, and not for the profit, honor, or private interest of any one man, family, or class of men. Therefore, the people alone have an incontestable, indefeasible right to institute government and to reform, alter, or totally change the same when their protection, safety, prosperity, and happiness require it." I mean, if you think about the history of human civilization, never was there any civilization that rested itself upon such poetry. Even Pericles, Greece, which gave rise to Plato and Aristotle and many of the Greek playwrights that we still study today, didn't have that kind of a beautiful statement at its core. So that's the love part. The love part is also the fact that I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri, in the heartland of the country, the gateway to the West, and as a kid was just absolutely corny about the American flag and the 4th of July and all things American. And I just fondly remember going down at the age of, you know, 8 and 9 and 10 to the underneath the arch and sitting above the Mississippi River and watching the fireworks explode over the great Mississippi with 100,000 people around me. And it just gave me goosebumps, and it still does today. I also, as corny as this is, and I'm a Gen Xer, so I'm not supposed to be this corny, I'm supposed to be much more ironic, take great pride in the fact that my family fought, and some of them died, in the American Revolution. So I feel like this is in my blood, and my love for this country runs very, very deep. So that was one of my major motivating forces.
You know, like Nick, I'm kind of corny for the... okay. For the 4th of July. I don't think I even told you this. My first job as a reporter in Kingsport, Tennessee was when I was, gosh, I think I was not even 20 years old yet. I got an internship at my hometown newspaper, and the first story I was assigned was covering the 4th of July parade in Kingsport, Tennessee. I was very fortunate. In fact, my first career was as a newspaper reporter. I was lucky to get a job after college in Memphis, which is on the other side of the state from Kingsport, and I was a reporter there. And then got a chance to cover the Tennessee legislature, and then finally was promoted to a position in Washington with Scripps Howard News Service, where I covered Congress and the White House and the Supreme Court for a few years. I had a longer career, though, in public relations. I left, quite frankly, because of the lure of a few extra bucks. PR people make more money than journalists do, and I wound up working for the insurance industry. Sometimes I've said that I spent 20 years on an undercover assignment inside the insurance industry. I many times while I was working for the insurance industry, I kept thinking maybe someday I would have a chance to return to journalism and share what I learned inside that industry, never really thinking that would ever come to pass. But I had a crisis of conscience toward the end of my career that led me to really assess what I was doing for a living. And I came to the conclusion that what I was doing in my job as head of corporate communications for one of the largest insurance companies was the exact opposite of what I was trying to do as a journalist years before. That became such a conflict for me that I ultimately just turned in my resignation. I didn't have the idea, though, that I would get involved in advocacy until I began noticing what was happening during the healthcare reform debate after Barack Obama was elected president and the healthcare reform debate was getting underway. I could tell that the strategy that I had actually worked on when I was inside the industry was being implemented. I had a kind of a unique role at Cigna. I was the chief spokesman for the company. I dealt with the media, but I also dealt with their government affairs people, and I spent a lot of time in Washington helping to develop a communication strategy for defending or explaining the industry's point of view on any issue that pertained to legislation and regulation. And one of the things that I'd worked on was a campaign to try to influence the debate on healthcare reform. And I saw that being implemented after I had left the company. And I became so upset with seeing that the words that I had actually been working on, the plan that I had been a part of, that I was really ashamed of, was actually being implemented. So I found out a way to get involved with advocacy and was invited to testify before a Senate hearing. It was something that I felt compelled to do. I felt that it was a way that I was, in some way, was making amends. That was also, as I said, my first career was as a journalist. I grew up in Mountain City, Tennessee, and Kingsport, Tennessee, two very small towns. Mountain City, a very poor part of the country, one of the poorest parts of Tennessee. The reason I mention that is because while I grew up there, my parents were able to put some money aside to enable me to be the first person to graduate from college, neither one of their families. And I felt often that I needed to do something to give back to my family and to that part of the world. It never occurred to me that it would take this, I would be taking this route to do that. I was fortunate in ways that I don't think a lot of young people today could be. I left college without any debt. My parents were able to put me through college, even though Dad was a factory worker. He had a job that doesn't even exist in Kingsport, Tennessee now. Most of those factory jobs have gone. So in many ways, I've been living the American dream. And I think that while I no longer live and work in Washington as I did when I was a reporter, I think about those times back when I was a reporter in the mid-70s. The city was so much different than what it is now, a very different place. There were not nearly as many lobbyists. There was not nearly the emphasis on raising money as there is now. When you go back to Washington, when I go back to Washington now, the place looks the same. But that's about, in many ways, it is such an entirely different place. The place is largely run by lobbyists. And the members of Congress, as we'll talk a bit more a bit later on, spend so much of their time dialing for dollars. And they don't call people like you and me. They call the very wealthiest people, people who have the ability to write big checks. And in that regard, this book is named A Nation on the Take because of what has happened over the last several years in Washington in particular, but also in the state capitals.
So the heartbreak part is that, and the reason why Wendell and I decided to do this book is because we feel as if money in politics is that thing that most Americans kind of know about and most Americans kind of hate, They also feel pretty hopeless about it. But the point that we're trying to make here is that it's reached the point of being a stage four cancer. It's not something that we can just kind of turn away from anymore in disgust. Obviously, you guys are not turning away. You're fighting for reform here. But here are some of the dimensions of that stage four cancer. The 2000 election cycle was a $3 billion election cycle. This year is expected to be a $10 billion election cycle. The rise of lobbying. When John Kennedy was elected president, there were 250 registered lobbyists in Washington. There are now 12,000 registered lobbyists in Washington. Last year, those lobbyists disclosed, and that's just what they have to disclose, $2.6 billion in expenditures. That's $600 million more than it actually costs to run Congress. The revolving door. In 1974, around 3% of former members of Congress left Capitol Hill and went to K Street to join the lobbying industry. Last year, 50% did exactly that. Time spent raising money. 20 years ago, members of Congress said they spent somewhere between 5 and 15% of their time raising money. They now spend half their time raising money. Representative Steve Israel, who represents a big chunk of Long Island, shocked Washington a couple months ago when he announced that he was not going to run again as a House member. He was the chief financial fundraiser for the DCCC for quite some time, and he wrote a piece in the New York Times about why, and he said, "I just can't do the fundraising anymore." He estimated that in the 15 years that he was in Congress, he spent 4,200 hours just in call time dialing rich people asking for money. If you stretch that out across a 40-hour work week, that means that 2.5 years straight he spent, basically would have spent, just dialing for dollars. Dan Glickman, who was a Blue Dog Democrat from Kansas, and then he was Clinton's agriculture secretary, and then he actually went and represented the motion picture industry in Washington, described it like this. "The sad truth is that given the frenetic search for money in federal congressional elections, there simply isn't enough time in the day to stay competitive in campaign finance and do the actual job of policymaking. I remember when I was first elected to Congress, I and many other House members would often go down to the floor of the House of Representatives and just listen to the debate. I may not have had an amendment to a bill or a particular interest in the issue, but I always felt that watching policy discussions and witnessing the crafting of laws was an important part of my day." Doesn't this sound wonderful? "It gave me the chance to educate myself and interact with members of Congress on both sides of the aisle. Today, most lawmakers would tell you that any free moment not used raising dollars is simply time wasted." The Cash Committee. So the Cash Committee is the nickname in Washington for the House Finance Committee. And it's not because they deal with finance, but because it's like winning a lottery ticket for fundraising. 60 of the 435 House members serve on the Finance Committee, not because it takes 60 brains to think through financial policy, but because it's just so lucrative. Last year alone, those 60 members collected $30 million directly from lobbyists and corporate executives from the finance industry. The rise of billionaire spenders. Since Citizens United was handed down in 2010, we've seen an explosion of centimillionaire and billionaire intervention in elections. Nick Confessore, my friend at the New York Times, nailed it with his story back in October when he chronicled how 158 families have supplied, or at the time had supplied, one half of the campaign cash in the presidential election cycle. The Koch brothers, as you guys probably know, have pledged, their network has pledged to spend $900 million in this election cycle, which is more than the DNC and RNC plan to spend combined. So the network of a single family is now dwarfing the financial power of both political parties. And then finally, dark money. This is money that's very hard to trace. It's run through 501c4 organizations. It's a total abuse of the 501c4 laws. They're supposed to be social welfare organizations. Karl Rove operates almost exclusively in C4s because he doesn't want anyone to see what he's doing. And we've seen a 5,000% increase in the deployment of dark money in elections since 2004. So those are some of the nasty numbers. But what we also point out in the book is that those things drive the very behaviors that we are all so concerned about right now, and in part that this election is being defined by. Those include cronyism. So if you take David Stockman as an interesting guy to think about cronyism, Stockman was Reagan's director of office management and budget. He wrote in his book recently, The Great Deformation, The Corruption of Capitalism in America, that the market system is no longer free today. He says, quote, the aggressive and proactive use of political resources to gain something from the governmental process that would otherwise not be achievable in the market is what we see now. Money dominates politics, and as a result, we have neither capitalism nor democracy. Oligarchy. This is Mark McKinnon, who was George W. Bush's communications director, writing in the Daily Beast about 7 months ago. He said, quote, let's call the system that Citizens United and other rulings and laws have created for what it is, an oligarchy. The system is controlled by a handful of ultra-wealthy people, most of whom got rich from the system and who will get richer from the system. And then finally, gridlock. We feel like this is one of the big failures of a lot of the reporting right now about gridlock in Washington is they're not drawing the money and politics connection. They just talk about the Tea Party. But instead, what we heard, what Wendell and I heard when we talked to members of Congress and senators, is that the reason why they aren't getting along is in part because they don't have time to get along. And for this, we would cite what Tom Harkin said. He said, quote, we used to have a Senate dining room that was only for senators. We'd go down there and sit around there, and Joe Biden and Fritz Hollings and Dale Bumpers and Ted Stevens and Strom Thurmond and a bunch of us, Democrats and Republicans. We'd have lunch and joke and tell stories and develop a great camaraderie. That dining room doesn't exist anymore. Not because people aren't going, but because, well, we're just not there. For instance, we're gone on Monday and Friday. Tuesday, we have our party caucuses. That leaves Wednesday and Thursday. And guess what people are doing then? They're out raising money. Tom Daschle, who is a member of my organization and works with us on a bunch of stuff, was at a press conference with us on Capitol Hill 2 months ago, and he said point blank, I couldn't run the Senate anymore because of all the fundraising that was going on. I just simply couldn't schedule votes.
Nick and I use a lot of numbers in this book, as you can imagine, and we use a lot of terms like crony capitalism and oligarchy and gridlock, but it's not just about that. What Nick and I try to do with this book is connect the dots for people to help folks see the linkages between money-driven corruption and the inability of our government to work as it should for our benefit. So the story we're really telling through Nation on the Take is a story about the loss of self-government. And by that we mean the loss of our collective power to solve our own problems. In the middle part of the book, we tell this larger story through the personal stories of everyday Americans. Folks like Bill and Faith Wildrick of Pennsylvania, who even though they both had jobs and health insurance, they're just barely able to make ends meet because of what they have to spend out of their own pockets every month for Bill's prescriptions. And that's thanks to the money that the pharmaceutical industry spends year in and year out to block any legislation or regulation that might make medications more affordable. Bill has hepatitis C, and he was put on a regimen of Sovaldi, which is made by Gilead, and it's $84,000 for 12 weeks of therapy. Yeah. And that's now their latest drug is Harvoni, which is even more expensive than that. So even though they have insurance, their out-of-pocket expenses to cover their co-payments and co-insurance is more than their budget will allow. We also tell the story of Lisa Douglas, a woman in Chicago, who's a mother of six, and for years she's been trapped in a seemingly never-ending nightmare of a struggle to keep her home out of foreclosure. And that is thanks to the hundreds of millions of dollars that the banking industry spent to shape the financial reforms that Congress passed 6 years ago in ways that benefit banks and mortgage companies and makes it actually hellishly difficult for many average folks to get the financial help they need and to stay out of bankruptcy and foreclosure. We could have gone on and on. There were many different examples. We chose five industries to, as I said, to help connect the dots for people. One that we didn't include, we did quite a bit of research, was student loans. As I mentioned earlier, I was able to leave college without any student debt. Now the average student with college loans has $35,000 in student debt. And those debts are almost impossible to discharge even if you file for bankruptcy. And that's because of the influence of lenders in 2005. They were able to make sure that in the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 2005, that a provision was included that makes it almost impossible for people with student loan debt to discharge those debts. To drive home the point of just how completely our system of government and our way of life has been shaped by big money from cradle to grave, we told the story of a newborn baby girl. Here's what we wrote about the system that really has been created by big money. Imagine a baby named Eve, born this morning in a hospital whose regulations, medical equipment, pharmaceuticals, staff training, and certification were partly created by the system. Little Eve will ride home tonight in a car that was engineered by the system as much as it was by engineers. The mileage it gets, how safe it is, the materials it's made of, what goes into the gas tank, how it's taxed, what comes out of the tailpipe. Eve will arrive at home, built to standards established in part by the system. Lobbyists, trade groups, phony citizens groups, and corporate executives have waged massive campaigns for decades that have determined the quality of every breath of air that Eve draws into her new lungs. Her mother's breast milk has already been infused with pesticides, herbicides, and hormone disruptors that chemical companies and their representatives have fought to keep on the market. Once Eve starts eating solid food, what other chemicals will she be consuming? Here's a spoiler alert. Less than a third of the 80,000 chemicals on the U.S. market today are regulated at all. So it's ultimately an unanswerable question. Was the food inspected? And if so, to what degree and by whom? The banking lobby has its fingerprints all over the regulations that shape her parents' mortgage, their taxes, their medical bills, their job opportunities. Eve can't escape the reach of the system. You can't. We can't. Government is us, and it's either working for us or it's working for those who are trying to rig it to get what they want, sucking our employees, our legislators, into their agendas and often diverting the resources, our tax dollars, into their pockets. The message of all these stories is that it is becoming increasingly difficult to truly solve any problem anymore for the common good. Even the financial reform that Congress passed in 2010 was partial reform that, first and foremost, protected the profits of the special interest. And certainly the same can be said for the health care reform law, the Affordable Care Act that Congress passed that same year. This is what we mean when we talk about the loss of self-government. The entire middle section of the book is, in essence, about what our nation's founders feared and hoped to guard against. They feared corruption above anything else. And by this, we mean not the corruption that inevitably occurs when some of the people we vote for are found to be taking a few bucks under the table. The founders knew that that kind of corruption would always be with us just because of human nature. The kind of corruption that worried them most was the bending of government away from the public good and toward the interest of the few. The few with the means, with the money, to buy influence, to buy public policy, to buy our government. Here's what Thomas Jefferson wrote exactly 200 years ago in a letter to a former senator who, like me, called Philadelphia home. "I hope," Jefferson wrote, "I hope that we shall crush in its birth the aristocracy of our moneyed corporations, which dare already to challenge our government to a trial of strength and bid defiance to the laws of their country. It was 200 years ago. Just imagine what Thomas Jefferson would think now.
So the hope part. Here's another Thomas Jefferson quote. "I hold that a little rebellion now and then is a good thing and as necessary in the political world as storms in the physical. It's a medicine necessary for the sound health of government." So, what can be done? Seattle actually is a great example, but there are four things. Unfortunately, everyone always says, well, what's the silver bullet? There is no silver bullet for this cause. There are four areas that we need to work on. Number one is new ways of financing campaigns. I truly believe the Seattle model is the most revolutionary model out there and would love to see it replicated at the federal level. But there are other models too, like New York City has a matching funds model in which every donation given to a city council candidate up to 175 is matched 6-1. So all of a sudden a $50 donor looks like a $350 donor to a potential politician. And if you look at what the Brennan Center has done when they've studied pre and post that system, pre that system, all the fundraising in New York City was occurring in deep red dots in the Upper East Side and Upper West Side of Manhattan, $2,000 plate dinners at wealthy people's apartments. Post that system, all of a sudden the entire city looks freckled, basically. All the boroughs look freckled because all the fundraising got pushed back out. And so what politicians are saying is that now instead of trying to figure out who can host a high dollar fundraiser for them, they're holding barbecues back home in the Bronx and Brooklyn and elsewhere with their constituents, $50, you know, ahead. And it's totally democratized the political financial power in the city, which then democratizes the rest of the power. There are other models too. Connecticut has a clean money model. Maine just, thank God, reinstated its model despite the fact that the Tea Party governor tried to strip all of the funding for it. But I think that Seattle is the most radical because there's zero financial barrier to participation. You know, akin to kind of what we did when we struck down the idea of a poll tax. That's what you all have just done with campaign finance. So hopefully the system will work really well in the next election, and we can then begin replicating it rapidly around the country. So that's number one. Number two, ethics and lobbying reform. Even if you do campaign finance, if you don't deal with the revolving door, you still have a huge problem. So our proposal in the book is to jam the revolving door at least 10 years. We talked to Jack Abramoff, the notorious lobbyist who you guys remember went to jail. Jack actually endorsed the book, and Jack said, he said, 5 years? He said, 5 years is nothing. I can get around 5 years. I just hire some person, I'd put them on the payroll, have them, you know, go out and play a lot of golf for 5 years, build some relationships, and then they could register as a lobbyist. You got to do 10. So that seems rather crucial. Transparency and disclosure. I think that in a way, transparency and disclosure has been overrated as the centerpiece, or a lot of people in Washington thinks that it should be the centerpiece of reform. It's important. It's kind of a base that we all need, but it's really, you know, right now 90% of the money in the system, you can see, is transparent. 10% is dark money. So we're doing pretty well with transparency. There are still improvements that need to get made. We need to get rid of 501c4 organizations entirely and make sure that the money flowing through them is transparent. And then finally, we need a cop on the beat. The Federal Election Commission is utterly broken. It has 6 commissioners, 3 Republicans, and 3 Democrats. They gridlock on all important issues, and as a result, the political class feels like it's the Wild West. Like, or maybe the better metaphor is they're like teenagers, and the parents are out of town, and they've got the run of the house. So they're just gonna do whatever they want, basically. Super PACs, as they exist today, probably would not exist if not for the Federal Election Commission, because they are not supposed to be coordinating with campaigns, and they are not supposed to be dedicated to a single candidate, but they're doing both. And the FEC won't do a thing about it. So we've got to fix the FEC also. That all sounds complicated, and this is obviously a fight that is fundamentally about power in this country and who has power and why. But one of the things we point out is that this is actually a very easy technical fix, unlike other things that we have to fix in this country. So here's what we write. Fixing most of this problem is technically remarkably simple compared to other things we need to fix. We could do it in a day with a single piece of legislation if we had the power to get the legislation passed. No pipes or wires or army bases have to be moved. No new power plants need to be built or smokestacks retrofitted. No cyber attacks needed to be defended against. No international humanitarian missions need to be launched. No families or individuals have to change the way they eat or drive or raise their children. No federal agency needs to be funded. No schools need to alter the way they educate their children. No workers need to be retrained. Those things, transportation, education, public health, national security, good jobs, those are very complicated things to fix. And by the way, many of them are much harder to fix because of the influence of money in politics. This, though, how money flows in and around our political system and our government, is, in light of those things, a technical tweak and should be something that we routinely do as Americans, almost like cleaning out your gutters after the fall leaves clog them up. What are we up against? For the sake of argument, let's say there are about 100,000 people who will fight like hell to make sure that no campaign finance measure can pass. 100,000 is likely even too high a number. I mean, I know a lot of lobbyists, for instance, who are completely sick of the game, and plenty of politicians too, and plenty of donors, political donors, by the way, cannot stand it because their phones are ringing 10 or 12 times a day with United States senators and House members on the other end of the line. And as one of them said to me, he said, "I just think it's pathetic." So let's stick with the 100,000. That's 0.03% of the United States population. We, the other 99.97%, need to push aside our cynicism and exhaustion and join with others from all walks of life to create a new, surprising, unstoppable movement for reform. And what if we fail? Then we will have certainly proven that, as Mark McKinnon said, an American oligarchy is no longer something that's just postulated intellectually, but it's quickly becoming a reality. So the last note that I wanted to point out is that I think that certainly even when, you know, in my younger life, when, kind of 1980s when I was becoming a teenager, and then even the 90s, democracy felt inevitable in some way, especially when the Soviet Union fell. And the theory was that somehow capitalism and democracy were the logical sisters, and if we could go in and start help capitalizing Russia, they would become logically a democracy that could then spread east to Asia. But unfortunately, that didn't happen. And if you look at South America right now, they're backsliding in terms of democracy. So the experiment of democracy itself no longer seems so inevitable. In fact, it seems like it's possibly something that might not exist in such great quantities 50 years from now. Much more articulate about this is a guy named Stein Ringen, who's a professor of sociology and history at Oxford. And he wrote this. He said, "It took only 250 years for democracy to disintegrate in ancient Athens. It would be 2,000 years before democracy was reinvented in the United States and with the United States Constitution, now as a representative democracy. Again, government by popular consent proved ingenious. The United States grew into the world's leading superpower, economically, culturally, and militarily. In Europe, democracies overtook authoritarian monarchies and fascist and communist dictatorships. Now, the second democratic experiment is approaching 250 years, 240 years this year, right? It has been as successful as the first, but the lesson from Athens is that success does not breed success. Democracy is not the default for human civilization. It is a form of government that must be created with determination and that will disintegrate unless it is dutifully nurtured. In the United States and Britain, democracy is disintegrating when it should be nurtured instead by bold leadership. If the lights go out in the model democracies, they will not stay on elsewhere." And so I think that we have to take that very, very seriously. And I know that this cause is one that does seem so overwhelming. I mean, the local victories are fantastic. Winning at the federal level, I know, seems huge. But I honestly have to say that it's not just that I worry about us not being able to fix the problems that we face in this country and that my children are going to face. It's that I actually worry that the experiment of democracy is losing and that it might not be around in 100 years if we don't fight like hell right now to restore it.
If you've been paying any attention at all to the presidential campaigns, and I know you all have, you know that Bernie Sanders is making a very big deal of big money in politics. And he really doesn't miss an opportunity to talk about the urgency of taking some action. And I think that undoubtedly played a big role in his victory here and in the other states where he's doing quite well. It's actually one of the centerpiece of his campaign. That's great. And Nick and I hope that he keeps talking about it and that he keeps talking about it all the way to Philadelphia where the convention will be held. But it might lead you to think that this is just a liberal cause. But folks, nothing could be really further from the truth. Polls consistently show that almost as many Republicans as Democrats believe that money plays too much of a role in American politics. There's a poll conducted last year by the New York Times and CBS News that showed that 84% of adults, including 80% of Republicans, think that money has too much influence in American politics. In that same poll, 85% said that they want to see campaign finance either fundamentally changed or completely overhauled. And on the issue of limiting contributions, 71% of Republicans, along with 80% of Democrats, said that they favored such limits. Both Nick and I know a lot of Republicans personally, believe it or not, and who were just as concerned about this as any Democrat. Several of them are actually on issue one's board. And there are a lot of Tea Party members who are also very engaged. In fact, one of the very first people I talked to about money and politics was a friend of mine who actually went on to become head of the Tea Party in Washington, D.C. And he said he got involved in politics because of just the disgust he saw based on local politics in Fairfax County, Virginia, where he saw developers just getting their way and pretty much buying what they wanted from local officials. One of the most active and effective groups in the movement is an organization called Take Back Our Republic, which was started by John Putner, who played a key role in the successful campaign to oust Eric Cantor a couple of years ago in the Republican primary in Virginia. Another conservative in this fight is Richard Painter, who worked for George W. Bush. In fact, he was his ethics czar. He's also a Minnesota law professor and the author of a new book called Taxation Only with Representation, The Conservative Conscience and Campaign Finance Reform. He wrote an op-ed in the New York Times recently, and this is one of the things he wrote. Why should conservative voters care? Well, first, big money in politics encourages big government. Campaign contributions drive spending on earmarks and other wasteful programs. Bridges to nowhere, contracts for equipment the military doesn't need. Solar energy companies that go bankrupt on the government's dime and for-profit educational institutions that don't educate. When politicians are dependent on campaign money from contractors and lobbyists, they're incapable of holding spending programs to account. Painter went on to quote Barry Goldwater, who wrote in his 1960 book, The Conscience of a Conservative, that, and this is what Goldwater wrote, in order to achieve the widest possible distribution of political power, financial contributions to political campaigns should be made by individuals and individuals alone. I see no reason for labor unions or corporations to participate in politics. Painter added that the current system is a betrayal of the vision of participatory democracy embraced by the founders of our country. They rebelled against oligarchy and corruption in England. They tossed the British tea into Boston Harbor in 1773 and demanded taxation only with representation. We should do the same. And Nick and I certainly agree with that, that indeed we should. In such an otherwise divisive time, we think that this might be the very thing that can reunite us as a country. As I said earlier, this is the one issue in which Democrats and Republicans and liberals and conservatives and independents agree on. And although the mainstream media is not really covering it, the revolution has really already begun. Liberals and conservatives have come together in places as different as far apart as Maine and Tallahassee, Florida, and here in Seattle. In Tallahassee, voters there approved measures to reduce the influence of big money on state and local elections. And this coming November, voters in at least five states, most of them red states, Arkansas, Arizona, Idaho, South Dakota, and Washington, will be voting on campaign finance measures. Before I turn it back over to Nick, I might want to say that the cynics and the naysayers, particularly those inside the Beltway, contend that this is just too hard to do, that we'll never be able to fix this because the wealthy and the powerful just have too much wealth and power. But we've done this before. In our book, we write about the times in our nation's history when we stood up to the powerful and the entrenched special interests, as we did during the leadership of Teddy Roosevelt. Roosevelt became the single greatest champion of campaign finance reform that the country probably has ever seen when he took on the so-called robber barons in the Gilded Age. And compared to many of the other victories in our history, what we need to do now actually seems a lot easier. Think about what we as a people have addressed over the years. The abolition of slavery, suffrage, civil rights, and marriage equality, to mention just a few. We look back to Abraham Lincoln, who said he hated the monstrous injustice of slavery because he said, as he said so eloquently, it deprives our Republican example of its just influence in the world. We look back to Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who had the audacity to believe that women should be able to vote and to suggest that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal. We look back to Martin Luther King, who moved us with and our lawmakers to action with that one unforgettable sentence that I think you probably all have heard many, many times. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And just last year, we heard one of the conservative members of the Supreme Court make the case that all of us should have the right to marry the one we love. As Justice Anthony Kennedy said of the plaintiffs in the majority opinion, their hope is not to be condemned to live in loneliness, excluded from one of civilization's oldest institutions. They ask for equal dignity in the eyes of the law. The Constitution grants them that right. So I mention these milestones in our history to remind us that it is the American way to tackle big issues and to constantly make progress toward that more perfect union. No one is more proud of our country and the promise it represents than Nick and I. We teamed up to write this book to hopefully make it more likely that that my son and his wife and Nick's kids and future generations who come after us will quite frankly still have that Republican example that Lincoln spoke about a century and a half ago.
That's it. So I'm sure there are plenty of questions, and probably even more knowledge that can be added to the conversation. Yes.
I guess I'm first of all pleased to hear that George Bush had an ethics. Sorry.
He was somewhere in the White House.
Talk a little bit about Billy Tozer.
Oh, Billy.
Probably the pillar of this whole problem.
Yeah. Yeah, Wendell, go ahead.
Yeah, Billy Tozer was a congressman from Louisiana. He's a Cajun, yeah, very proud of his Cajun heritage. He was both the Republican and a Democrat. He was elected as a Democrat when the winds changed in Washington. The Republicans took over the House during the Gingrich Revolution. He switched parties and was the first member, and I think the only one, to have served in leadership positions in both parties. He was also a very good friend and in fact, very loyal foot soldier for the pharmaceutical industry. Got many campaign contributions over the years from pharmaceutical companies, and he was very instrumental in the passage of legislation that created the Medicare Part D prescription drug benefit in a way that benefited pharmaceutical companies and insurance companies, first and foremost. He and his colleagues made certain that legislation did not contain a provision that enabled Medicare to negotiate with drug companies for better prices. So Medicare, to this day, cannot negotiate for better prices. And advocates...
Immediately after that, what happened?
Well, the...
Went to work for Johnson & Johnson.
Exactly. He went to, well, after he left Congress, after the passage of that legislation, he went to work for the pharmaceutical industry, making $2 million a year. Yeah, no. Yeah, a lot of the staff went with him.
He resigned early, in fact, from office. Didn't even finish out his term.
Yeah, and during his time as head of pharma, he led a platoon of lobbyists during the healthcare reform debate after Barack Obama was elected president, and once again was able to make sure that the pharmaceutical industry's interests were protected. He cut a deal with the White House right off the bat before. The first word of legislation was written. So he single-handedly probably has created enormous profits for the pharmaceutical industry and the insurance industry. And if one of the reasons you guys are, all of us are paying more for pharmaceuticals is because of Billy Tozan.
Ladies and gentlemen, could you use those microphones that are right over here on the sides so that everybody can hear the question and we can capture it for our recording? Thank you very much.
So, you talk about how you know Democrats and Republicans who want to change this issue. I want you to talk a bit more about how much of a role the RNC and DNC has in preventing any progress in what you spoke on.
So, it's interesting because they... Both parties, the politicians in both parties are utterly exhausted by the system at this point. I mean, we didn't talk to a single politician who enjoys the job of fundraising and dialing for dollars, half their time. And what we didn't talk about is where they have to do. They can't make any fundraising phone calls from Capitol Hill, so they're shuttled off to the DNC and RNC headquarters, where they sit in little tiny cubicles with call sheets, stacks of call sheets this thick, and a can of soda, and they've got, oftentimes they'll have an aide standing by who, while they're talking to one person on the phone, will dial the next person so that they don't even have to take time to dial. And they're doing that anywhere between 3 and 4 hours a day. The DCCC, in fact, stipulated to new Democrats coming in to Congress in 2015 that they should spend 4 hours a day dialing for dollars and then another hour a day doing what's called strategic outreach, which means in-person fundraising in Washington, typically from the industries that they're supposed to be regulating. So if you're on the Finance Committee, you're at Charlie Palmer's Steakhouse, which is 2 blocks from the Capitol, having lunch with bank lobbyists. There are very, very few people who enjoy this process at this point. And as I said, the political donors are also really sick of it. I mean, if you just think about the difference between $3 billion total expenditures in 2000 versus the $10 billion this year, that's $7 extra billion that would otherwise be going into philanthropy, like into schools and homeless shelters and conservation land, because that money's coming primarily from wealthy individuals who would be putting it elsewhere somewhere. So the DNC and RNC, of course, facilitate this activity. But they also know that the treadmill is moving so fast right now that the politicians are getting flung off of it, just like Steve Israel, who resigned because of it. So they know that something's got to give. What they will be most concerned about is whether or not the politicians will have enough money, if we develop new ways of financing campaigns, to run viable campaigns. What they saw with the presidential public financing system is that because it wasn't appropriately indexed, people started opting out of it. You guys will remember, in fact, Barack Obama was the first presidential candidate to opt out of the presidential public financing system, which basically killed it. And it's because it would only provide him with $150 million to run for re-election, and he knew that he could raise $1 billion. So as long as so the key for the RNC and DNC, for the political class, is to make sure that the money provided by new systems is enough money. If it's not enough money, then they'll probably oppose it. If it's enough, then they'll go for it.
I might want to say that Nick and I were interviewed recently by on a radio program that one of the co-hosts is Michael Steele, who's the former head of the RNC. And he acknowledged that one of the things he hated most about that job was raising money, was begging for money.
Yeah. Given the favorable statistics, polls, and the anecdotes that you recite, why is the clear champion of the cause losing?
Bernie?
Yes.
I think that's much more complicated, right? I mean, you know, self-proclaimed socialist Jew from Brooklyn, you know, running for president of the United States is not easy. And a guy who is known in Washington as a horrible curmudgeon and who never wanted to play along with the Democrats and admitted that the only reason why he was running as a Democrat this year is because he couldn't imagine getting ballot access as an independent. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there are all kinds of things that are dragging down the Bernie campaign, but obviously the message, his message is resonating. And listen, Ted Cruz talks in almost every speech about what he calls the Washington cartel, which is the marriage of corporations and lobbyists making policy. Trump, obviously, is pretty good on this issue. He talks about how he can't be bought. Everyone else on the stage is bought. He can't be bought. And Hillary has the most robust campaign finance platform that she's ever embraced in her entire life. She doesn't talk enough about it, but it's incredibly well done. So the issue is there. But I agree, you know, and Bernie has driven it harder than anyone. But, you know, we're not single-issue voters in this country. Unless you're lying guns.
Okay, I won't take any more time, but this is so overwhelming an issue, and the candidacy, at least in the Democratic Party, is so black and white in terms of contributions. I can't imagine that all of those other considerations, whether it's Brooklyn or Jew or whatever, wouldn't be overridden if there were truly the kind of public support that you talk about, and that support coming even from the participants, the politicians.
There's public support, and I guess I'll draw one distinction. There's public support in the polls. But what is lacking, and Nick and I know this to be the case, and something that we're going to be working on going forward, is there really has to be a movement more organized than exists right now. There are a lot of organizations like Nick's and others that are in this fight, but there's a lot of work yet to do.
You've mentioned that one of the primary concerns of the establishment of both parties is, okay, if we bring out reform, will we still have enough money to run viable campaigns? So I got two questions. The comments you made about all the time taken by candidates, does that also apply, for instance, to someone like Jim McDermott, the 7th Congressional District here in Washington, which is pretty much a slam dunk for whoever gets the Democratic nomination for that district? Are they also spending that amount of time? And the other question is, the amount of money itself, will merely public funding of elections reduce the amount of money that basically, when Reagan's FCC eliminated the fairness doctrine, threw every single candidate into the open arms of big money?
You're a dead ringer for George Lucas, by the way. Has anyone ever said that to you?
No, he's a dead ringer for
you. Oh, he's a dead ringer for you. One of the most miserable things about raising money in Washington is that as you gain leadership in the political party, the fundraising pressure on you rises exponentially. So even if you're in a safe district, what you're probably doing is you're seeking to be a committee chair, and in addition to that, possibly seeking some kind of fundraising role within your political party. The reason these are called leadership PACs normally, and the reason why is because then you've got a bucket of money that you can hand out to your fellow Democrats or Republicans who are competitive seats. They then owe you an IOU, so when it comes time to vote for your committee chairmanship, they're going to vote for you. One of the guys who works directly with us at Issue One is this great guy named Tim Romer, who's a Blue Dog, former Blue Dog Democrat from Indiana, and was ambassador to India. And he said, you know what, Nick? He said, the problem is that, like, here you are, all of a sudden you've got a committee chairmanship, and instead of spending 50% of your time fundraising, you now have to spend 75% of your time fundraising right at the moment when you should actually be figuring out how to organize your committee and study the issues. So unfortunately, the guys in the safe seats, what they do is they use that as a launch pad to start buying power within the party itself. So that has to be addressed. The second question.
He mentioned the fairness doctrine.
Yeah. Listen, I mean, the if you want to get rich, go buy up a bunch of TV stations in Florida and Ohio, you know, every other year, and then flip them after the election's over. It's ridiculous. And TV stations can charge, so 80% of the money goes directly into TV ad buys. And those stations can charge more or less whatever they want to charge. So their prices are hugely inflated, typically. If the Fairness Doctrine was still in effect, and we forced the public airwaves, our airwaves, we forced free airtime for candidates, I think that would have somewhat of a ameliorative effect, but not a whole lot. I mean, I was talking to the head of the Democrats Senate Super PAC, it's called Majority PAC, a couple weeks ago, and she said, great, Nick, give us a bunch of free airtime, and then we'll just buy all the rest of it. So I think the mentality in Washington is it's like the nuclear arms race between Russia and the U.S. You know, we already have enough nuclear weapons to destroy the Earth 5,000 times over. We for some reason, we couldn't stop. And I think it's the same thing with the political class. Mm-hmm. They'll just keep buying up everything in sight, even if we give them free airtime.
So back to the hope part of your speech, you talked about that a single piece of legislation could be transformative. What are the paths to get the Senate Majority Leader and the Speaker of the House to actually bring forth such a bill? Can you see that, and what would be the push to get him to do that? Because every year they talk about it, and then nothing comes up. So what would be the path that would actually spring it forward if it's so compelling?
You want to talk about it, Wendell?
I'll start. It'll be obviously very difficult in the Senate because Mitch McConnell is probably the biggest obstruction. But it can be done. I mean, legislation is indeed possible, and the makeup of Congress does indeed change. And so that's one of the reasons why it's so vitally important to vote and pay attention to who you're voting for in November.
John Sarbanes, congressman from Maryland, son of Paul Sarbanes, the former senator, has a piece of legislation called the Democracy for All Act, which would create a matching fund system for congressional campaigns. It has 158 Democratic co-sponsors on it. And on the Senate side, Durbin has proposed something similar and is collecting support. It's going to take two things in my mind. Number one, the political repositioning of this cause away from the left. As long as campaign finance reform is seen as a lefty giveaway cause, we're not going to get it done in this country today. Not just in Washington, but also in most of the states. I don't know if you guys have run the numbers recently in the states, but here's the deal. Only seven states in this country are what are called blue trifecta states, where you've got a Democrat governor and Democrats control both chambers of the legislature. Seven. 23 are red trifecta states. The rest are divided government. There are more Republican state legislators than there ever have been since 1920. So, you know, this promise of the great progressive, rising progressive majority that we keep hearing about with millennials and Latinos, it's not happening. And so as long as this is seen as like a big lefty cause, it's not going to happen. So we've got to reposition it as a centrist cause, an American cause, and a cause that we all care about because we all care about preserving what the Founding Fathers started. Number one. Number two, it's going to take bringing the mob to the gates of the castle. When you talk to politicians about this, current politicians, what they say is, I don't hear a whole lot about it. I don't get phone calls about it. I get phone calls about drug pricing, about guns, about abortion, about X, Y, and Z. I don't hear enough about this. And until they hear enough about it, until they actually feel like their jobs are on the line because they are taking the wrong stance, they're not going to feel compelled to act. So we've got to create a much more vibrant and powerful and voracious movement than what currently exists.
So this is kind of another follow-up question, and you might have answered this already, and this might sound naive in asking it. But if, as you say, so many politicians and so many of the big money donors hate having to spend so much of their time dialing for dollars, why are they doing so little to change it?
I think the treadmill metaphor is the right metaphor. I don't know if you guys are ever on a treadmill and you've got it going so fast that you're having to almost sprint to stay on it. The last thing that you can imagine doing is figuring out how to change the scenario. You're just sprinting as fast as you can to keep up with the speed of the treadmill. And I think that these folks are in a constant, perpetual campaign mentality. The moment they get reelected, they start fundraising the day after, in many cases. So they're just like, they just can't see beyond it, basically. A, B.
But there's still been bills that they, all they got to do is put their name on it to co-sponsor.
Yeah,
right?
So
that
B,
doesn't take
so,
a lot of time.
So B, there obviously is an incumbent protection issue. They feel like, as much as they hate it, once they are elected and have name recognition and have contacts with the donors, they're safe. They can raise more money than any challenger could. So this is the way they keep their job.
Right.
So
that makes sense.
Yeah. So we obviously that is, you know, that's the pieces of the psychology that we're going to have to fight the most against. But what we're hoping is that the exhaustion part of it will begin overcoming the incumbent protection part.
So we should speed up the treadmill.
Right. right.
Yeah, my question is about political advertising, especially the role of ads on television. I noticed up through the 2010 election, ads on television never had an effect on me. I don't pay any attention to them, but it did seem to have an effect. You could see that reading news reports, et cetera, across the nation. But what I noticed in 2012 was that the impact of that was starting to diminish. That people like me, I think especially millennials, they just bypassed it. They just ignored it. We used our DVR capacities and we just, you know, skipped all that stuff. Don't you think that at least with respect to that, that the power of that of television advertising, at least through 2010, is diminishing? And it's sort of like money down a rat hole now?
I think it's probably not as important as it once was. We have a lot more ways to communicate now. The internet has enabled campaigns to reach people in ways that simply wasn't available to us in years past. So it's not as ultimately important as it once was, but it's still very persuasive and makes a difference. Otherwise, we wouldn't be seeing as much money spent as we currently do.
The problem is the swing voters too.
Right.
It's that mushy middle 4 to 5% of the voters who truly, for some reason, don't have no clue who they're going to vote for a week before an election.
And are probably not here too.
Right, right, and right. They are, in terms of the demographics, they're still heavily influenced by TV ads. A lot of people think that online advertising will start supplanting TV advertising because you can do such insane micro-targeting with online advertising, but that also becomes an expensive proposition because online advertising is literally limitless. There's limitless real estate, so there are tens of thousands of different places that you could go with that. The other kind of creepy thing that we're starting to see, which is, and Democrats are doing it this year, there's a Democratic operative named David Brock, who is running a thing called American Bridge, which is a pro-Hillary super PAC. He bought up, it's not a huge deal, so it didn't get a lot of reporting, but he bought a media establishment called Blue State Digital, and he's now using it as a phony front for like fake news, fake pro-Hillary news. So I think you're going to start seeing more of that also. Obviously Fox News is already kind of a version of that for the Republican Party, just as MSNBC is for the Democrats, but I think you're going to see more kind of phony media outlets being propped up all over the place, which can be an expensive proposition.
My issue has to do with the machinations that happen after people are elected, such as sequestration for the budget, where the 2% that was supposed to be paid to physicians because of the Affordable Care Act was never paid, so there's extreme apathy on the federal level to even pay people that went to school for 12 years and are doing an essential public service. In Washington State, we have the same thing here because we are not funding basic education despite a Supreme Court ruling finding us in fault. Once again, nobody seems to care about that. So it's great if we can have campaign finance reform, but I have a level of concern about the apathy that seems to be epidemic for people that are elected officials. What can you say that's going to give me hope for my son, who's 19 and wants to you know, have a positive outlook on his country?
Well, we don't, Nick and I don't suggest that campaign finance reform or what we write about will be the, again, the silver bullet or what will fix all that ails the country, but it is a very important component. But again, I think the public needs to understand what's at stake. I think we talk about the rebellion or the need for a revolution that Bernie talks about too. It's absolutely vital. I think it will. I think there is a lot of cynicism, certainly, and apathy that is a result of people feeling that the system is rigged because of money and politics.
Yeah, the striking thing about the polling is that whereas 80 to 90% of the public, Democrats, Independents, and Republicans, feel as if the system is fundamentally rigged or broken, only 7% in that same poll said that they thought it would be fixed. So you see this deep despair, intense despair, and that's what you know. Frankly, that's what like you guys are gonna with your victory last November in Seattle. That's what you're gonna help overcome, is to show that it's possible.
Thank you.
I have a quick question. Why are our campaign dates so long? In Great Britain,
I know.
I think they campaigned for, 6 weeks? And one of the reasons so much money is required, and I guess they love having long campaigns, those who benefit by it, but why can't we shorten the whole campaign season? Who controls that? Do you have any sense?
That's our next book. No, it's impossible, actually. It is impossible because, so New Hampshire, for instance, in its state constitution says, mandates that it has to be the first in the country primary. So you know, you basically have to get every other one of the dominoes to shift before New Hampshire was willing to shift. It's just impossible. And I think that, frankly, having a bunch of friends in New Hampshire, they love the attention that they get. They love the money, they love the drive-throughs with the politicians, they love being so important, so I just don't think it's going to happen, sadly.
We should be able to shorten the time, even if you have New Hampshire as the first. What about all the other states? They don't have to take as long as they do.
Oh, you can compress it all. I suppose you can compress it all.
We should compress
it. But I think a lot
there
of them...
There should be some
limitation. I think a lot of them like their own cameos, though. I don't know. Yeah.
Somebody's making an awful lot of money over a long period of time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, the political consultants certainly are. The TV. Yeah.
You say that as long as this is perceived as a liberal issue, we're going to have an uphill battle to be able to make progress with it. Is it therefore, does it follow that the Tea Party is creating some pressure on the other side that maybe we should be very happy about?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They are, you know, the Tea Party folks are deeply concerned about cronyism, mm-hmm. and about the moneyed establishment within the Republican Party that they feel like has locked them out of everything. If you look at, so back in November when the Congress was finishing up business before the holidays, there was this huge omnibus piece of spending legislation went through, and one of the things that McConnell attached to it was a provision that would allow, that basically struck down a little campaign finance rule that would allow the political parties to raise more direct, what's called hard money, than they previously could. The Tea Party raged against it, just as much as the progressives raged against it. So you are seeing, and as Wendell mentioned also in Tallahassee, you're seeing an interesting marriage of grassroots Bernie kind of progressives with, it's not real, I can't figure out whether they're Rand Paul Tea Party types or what type, but with Tea Party types mm-hmm. who feel as if both parties have been hijacked by Wall Street and the wealthy, and they want to see some kind of a revolution occur from the bottom up. So this group, Take Back Our Republic, that Wendell mentioned earlier, is headed by a guy named John Pudner. John Pudner ran Dave Bratt's campaign against Eric Cantor. He's the guy who Tea Partied Eric Cantor. And he lives in Alabama, and he has 9 children, and he learned politics at the heels of Ralph Reed doing Christian coalition organizing, and he's the real deal. So he's not great on gay marriage and other stuff that maybe some people in this room are, but he is the real deal, and he thinks that our republic has been hijacked by big money. So I think there is something really fascinating that's occurring, but it's going to take a great act of trust on both sides for progressives to reach out to Tea Party people and create this potentially extremely powerful but strange bedfellow coalition.
So that's something we should be working on?
Absolutely. Yeah.
We have time for these last two questions, and then we'll be out of time for the evening.
So you may not have heard of Initiative 1434, which has been filed with the Secretary of State in Washington, and it is being run by Represent Us. And they are doing exactly what you were just suggesting, making sure that the campaign committee includes Republicans, Democrats, well, I don't know about Democrats, League of Women Voters, and a Tea Party person. And we're not ready to move it ahead unless they had that combination of people involved. And it's fashioned after the Seattle initiative. And so I'm hopeful that the people in Washington State will also see that it's really important. Fix Democracy First works on these issues in this state, and we're hopeful that it doesn't interfere with Initiative 735, which, if people get confused, like they often do when you have a bunch of initiatives on the ballot. But I think that it's promising, and we would be the first state to have that kind of campaign financing and regulations around lobbying and the revolving door. And so I'm hopeful that people in this room will look for it and look for the petitions that are being circulated now and that it gets on the ballot. And, you know, we were talking on the way down here, a few of us, about Trump. And the question is, some people think Trump is a good thing because he has his own money. And mm-hmm. therefore, he doesn't have to ask people, and he could be more independent. Do you think that's correct?
Well, Wendell and I get asked, well, first of all, congratulations on the initiative coming up. I think that's huge. Wendell and I get asked all the time about Trump and Bush. And the question goes something like, well, does money in politics really matter? Because if you look at Bush, he raised $100 million, and he's out of the scene. And Trump is self-financing. And our simple answer is that no amount of money can overcome a lackluster candidate whose brother was a disaster. And the Trump message is you've got to be a billionaire to become president of the United States. So no, like both of those messages are terrible. Now, I just think that like this is just a disastrous year for the Republican Party. But yeah, wrong message. Yeah.
Earlier, you mentioned that there's a four-pillar platform to kind of attack this problem. If I'm remembering correctly, transparency, 501c4s, FEC, and the lobbyists. Do you see taxation as being any part of this, as closing corporate loopholes or raising the marginal tax rate, or is that just going to conflate two issues and kind of alienate one side versus the other?
I think that conflates it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you got to keep it clean. And you've also got to keep the message. The message will shift. Like I was just talking to Jonathan, and they, the corruption, the anti-corruption message in Washington doesn't seem to resonate as much as the kind of pro-democracy message does. So I think you've got to be flexible on message, but when it comes to policy, you've got to really stay focused on the problem itself.
Maybe somebody
Go for it.
Oh, okay, I'll talk. Somebody may have asked as I stepped out momentarily, but going forward, what kind of a strategy do you see to bring a country with all of its states and regions together to make this work? Who's going to organize? Who's going to fund it?
Right.
Is there a central strategy? There is more than one organization working on this. How's that going to happen?
It can happen because of the ways that coalitions come together for other issues. The healthcare reform legislation was passed, despite its shortcomings, because of a coalition of groups that came together to push forward healthcare reform. So it does take that, absolutely. It takes a movement. It takes a grassroots support. It will take educational. It'll take getting people to understand that if you are supporting, if your issue is going beyond the Affordable Care Act, you first have to address money and politics before there's much of a chance of doing better than what we got. So you do need to. It is possible, as Nick said, also. Different messages will work in different states and different parts of the country and to different audiences, but it is possible to bring disparate groups together and people from both ends of the political spectrum together.
I think, as Nick said, not enough legislators are hearing about this problem because the problems that have been caused by this problem are overwhelming the response of the general public to their representatives. Yeah. So, you know, what's a timeline? Do you guys have a timeline?
You never know in this country, right? I mean, honestly, like, I cannot imagine Wendell and I, you know, updating our book in 10 years. If we do, then we're cooked, in my mind. So I think that within 10 years, we need a profound victory on this issue. I think really, within 5 years, we should be looking at some kind of a massive overhaul of the system. And I think that things can happen in a, like lightning sometimes in America, when the right kinds of energy emerge. There have been 600 Anti-Citizens United resolutions that have passed at the city, county, and state level since 2010, 600 of them. That's occurring organically. That's not funded efforts. I mean, just like the ballot initiative this year, these guys, Jonathan's doing it with 90% volunteers, you said. So there's something occurring in this country, like the cage is getting rattled in really interesting ways. And when you see the Tea Party propping up its own campaign finance organization, when you see the polling going through the roof, when you see it really much more a part of the political dialogue than it ever has been in any election cycle in my lifetime, something is emerging. Yeah. There is much better coordination with the national groups that work on this, Common Cause, Public Citizen, my organization, the PIRGs. We have regular meetings now, weekly meetings where there's coordination occurring. The funding of the movement is starting to get ramped up. There are more centimillionaires and billionaires showing up for this fight, which is great. And the great irony is it's going to take big money to fight big money, but that's all right. That's what it takes in this country. And then finally, I would say that, again, I wouldn't rule out the level of exhaustion within the political class. I think that they are beginning to understand that this is just not sustainable anymore, and they're going to start looking for smart, viable, politically well-positioned, and that's the key, politically well-positioned solutions. So if we can all successfully make this an everyone cause and not just a liberal cause, we can start lining up, racking up more of those Republican votes in Washington. Here's the simple math, and then I'll let you guys go. We need 60. This is a generous number. We actually need 49. But let's say we need 60 Republicans to get to 218 in the House and to get to a 60 filibuster-proof majority in the Senate. Okay? If the Democrats take back the Senate in November, which I think is very likely, then that reduces the mass significantly in the Senate side. Yeah. So we're down to, like, instead of 49, we're down to, at that point, what, 43 or so. 43 Republicans is all we need to be able to get legislation passed in Washington, because we're already at 158 with Sarbanes legislation. That should not be an impossible task for us. And if we can just focus our guns and all of our energy appropriately and accordingly, I have great hope that we can start racking up some serious victories. Thanks, everyone.